You know, so good and important for us to pray together and pray as a family, and great to be together on this long weekend. Great to have you worshiping with us online if you weren't able to be here with us today. Great crowd today. It is a beautiful family day long weekend, isn't it? I mean, how about that? It feels like spring out there, but I hate to break it to you. It ain't spring yet. We're probably still going to get some snow, so hang in there. But I'm going to the driving range this afternoon. I don't know what anybody else says, but I'm going to make it happen. And it's so beautiful, so great to have this long weekend. Great that you chose to be here with us today. We're going to start the message today by having some fun. How many know God created fun? Yeah, so it's good to have fun in church, right? Especially on Family Sunday. And how many of you have ever been to a professional basketball game? You ever been to quite a few people? Maybe you have seen this at the game you went to, or maybe you even saw it online or on TV. That sometimes what they'll do at halftime is they'll invite a stranger to come out of the crowd and try and take a shot from half court. And if they make the shot, they win a prize, right? How many have seen or heard something like that? Well, we're going to do something similar today. And what we're going to do is we're going to invite some people to come up and try that. How many of you have ever played basketball on a team before? Let me see your hand. Hold up real high. You played basketball on a team. All right, Pastor Cheryl's going to keep those hands up. Pastor Cheryl's going to pick two people to come on up. And here's what we're going to do. We're going to have a little competition. Keep those hands up if you played on a team. Yes, Kurt Cedars. I know. He actually runs our basketball thing coming here. So he's good. Come on up, Kurt. And what we're going to do is we're just going to have you take a couple of shots. It should be fairly easy, right? Just like that. You take a couple of shots, and we're going to see who wins the most. Come on up. Come on up. Give him a hand. Come on up. 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 Okay, so here's what we're going to do. And this is actually for a prize. Oh, man. You can get right up there. That was nice. That was well done. So the winner, we're going to do this on aggregate, okay? The winner actually gets two free tickets to Raptors 905 game that we're doing on March break. So this is actually a good prize, okay? So we just maybe stand over there. Whoever wants to go first, right? Maybe stand over there, and we'll just take two shots. Here we go. Oh, there's one. One more shot. One more shot. It's like two foul shots. Oh, that's going to be tough. Okay. All right. Let's see what you can do. Two shots. Oh, all right. Take one more. Okay, that's okay. Stay here. Because what we're going to do is, in the NBA, they wouldn't give you a second chance, but we're Christians, right? Okay, so we're going to give you another chance. So here's what I want you to do, though. I want you to shoot granny style. How many know what granny style is, right? Yeah. Two shots, granny style. It's still on aggregate, so he might miss two granny shots. So, all right, no. Okay, try again, do it again. Both between the legs. Okay. Take your granny shots there, Kurt. Let's see. Let's see if he can go 4 for 4. No pressure. One more. That's all right. Thanks, guys. Everybody give him a hand. That was great. There's your tickets. All right, what does that have to do with anything? Well, besides the fact that we like to have fun in church, and you can go tell your friends that we played basketball in our church on Sunday, there's a social phenomenon that I want to talk to you about for a moment. It's been highlighted by a Canadian journalist, author, and speaker named Malcolm Gladwell. In his latest project called Revisionist History, he highlights something really interesting that's happened. He says that our perception of the world changes with the passage of time. So he talked about this NBA Hall of Famer named Rick Barry. Rick Barry was incredible from the foul line. 89.3% from the foul line over his career. But what was unique about Rick Barry is he shot it granny style. Everyone else shot overhand, he shot underhand. And he was so incredibly good at it. And Gladwell points out that there's a lot of bad foul shooters in the NBA today that would do so much better if they shot granny style. But they won't do it because they think it makes them look silly. They won't do it, even though it means that their team would win more games, because down at the end of a basketball game, there's all kinds of fouling to stop the clock, and everybody goes to the line. They would get more points, win more games, win more championships. They still won't do it because they feel like they'll be ridiculed by their teammates or ridiculed by the fans, and they think it'll cramp their style, and they won't do it. Even though it would make them more marketable as a player. They would make more money as a professional athlete because their percentages would go up, because they're getting more points, which means teams would want them to play for them, which means they would make more money, and they still won't do it because they're afraid it makes them look silly. It make everybody will mock their style. Gladwell even points out that this is proven to be more effective by another Hall of Fame basketball player named Wilt Chamberlain. Wilt Chamberlain, arguably one of the best basketball players in history. He was notoriously awful from the foul line, and yet he learned from Rick Barry, and so he decided to give it a shot. He said, for 1 year, I'm going to shoot underhanded, and that's what he did. And in that year, his free throw shooting percentage skyrocketed. He played so much better from the line. The year that he shot the foul shots underhanded, had his best season. He even got the most points for any individual player in a game still to this day. He scored 100 points in one game himself. In that game, he went 28 for 32 from the line. Best ever. And guess what happened? The next year, he went back to shooting overhand. The next year, he went back to shooting overhand, and his free throw percentage plummeted. Even though he had proven, what would make a Hall of Fame basketball player like Wilt Chamberlain see a proven method in his own game and reject it? It was the best method to overcome his own flaw. He even saw another Hall of Famer use it successfully, and he would reject it. Why would he do this? Well, because Chamberlain is a lot like us. We often allow the crowd to dictate our behavior. Instead of being like Barry, who would do what was right and do what was best regardless of the social cost. And to this day, there are so many basketball players in the NBA that have an awful foul shooting percentage, but they've adopted Chamberlain's style of shooting instead of Barry's style of shooting. Why? Because they're a lot like you and me. Even though they would win more games and they'd score more, they think they would be embarrassed. Chamberlain said he felt like a sissy when he shot it underhanded. That's why he didn't want to do it. That's why the players don't want to do it today. Even though at the end of the game, there's this strategy by teams where they know who's the worst at the foul line, and so they do this strategy called hack-a-shack. It's after Shaquille O'Neal, who is terrible from the line, and so they'll go to the worst foul shooter on the team, and they'll purposely foul him to send them to the line because they know they're going to miss the shot. They're more embarrassed about shooting it underhand than they are being pointed out as the worst one on the team about shooting foul shots, right? It doesn't make any sense. And like they'd be willing, most teams actually pull those guys right out of the game, because they know the strategy the other team is going to employ. And yet, they still won't do it. We can't really get down on these guys, can we? Because you and I do the same thing. So often, we allow the crowd to dictate our behavior. So often, we allow what other people might think about us define and direct what we are going to do and how we are going to behave. Even though there's things that we know we should do, we do this even in our relationship with God, don't we? There's things in our faith that we know God would want us to do or say in the midst of a circumstance that we're in, and yet And yet we won't do it. I mean, something as simple as maybe bowing our head to pray before a meal at a business luncheon. But we won't do it because we're afraid what our colleagues might think or say about us. It'd be socially awkward, so we won't do it. Or maybe in front of your friends at school to bow your head and pray. You know, we don't really want to do that because the social cost. It could be as something as serious as actually sharing our faith, telling people about our knowledge of who Jesus is and how he's transformed our lives. And it's changed our lives. It could change their life. It could change their eternal destiny. And yet we still don't do it. Because we're more like Chamberlain than we are like Barry. You know, we're called to live bold lives of worship before God. Not just in here, you know, where we're just singing and celebrating and lifting our hands and all that stuff. We're called to live these bold lives of worship out there too. You know, I want to suggest to you that if our worship depends on how we think other people feel about us, we might actually just be worshiping ourselves and not God. Would you turn with me in your Bibles to 2 Samuel? And we're going to continue our series today called The Big Picture. And we started this series at the beginning of the year, and we're asking God to give us the eyes of faith to see beyond the circumstances, the moments that we're in, and to see it in the context of the bigger picture, the bigger purpose that God has for our lives. And we're learning this through the life of King David, the most exhaustive biography in Scripture, right from childhood right through to death. And even though David messed up so many times and didn't do things right, we're thankful that Acts 13:36 says he did the will of God in his own generation. And that's our hope and that's our prayer, that we would be able to do the same thing. Now, last week, we came to this important moment where King Saul, this vengeful, jealous, brutal king who had been pursuing David, trying to kill him, we came to this point where he died in battle. And so this prepares the way, this prepares the opening for David to actually become king. He was anointed to become king. It was prophesied to become king. This finally opens the door for that to take place. But like so many other things in David's life, this did not happen quickly or smoothly or without challenges, kind of like our lives. So there's two main obstacles in the way before David would become king. One of them was Saul's son, Ishbosheth. It's a bit of a mouthful. Ishbosheth did not die in the battle. So three of Saul's sons died, including Jonathan. We talked about that. But Ishbosheth, Saul's son, did not die. So it just was logical for a lot of people to make Saul's son the next king of Israel. This is what the Bible says. But Abner, son of Ner, the commander of Saul's army, had already gone to Mahanaim with Saul's son, Ishbosheth. There he proclaimed Ishbosheth king over Gilead, Jezreel, Ephraim, Benjamin, the land of the Asherites, and all the rest of Israel. If you're like, oh man, this is David's opportunity to become king, and now Saul's son's already the king of Israel, so David can't become king. Well, there was an opportunity for David to gain some leadership, because remember, there's two kingdoms at this time, right? There's Israel and there's Judah. So David in this moment actually becomes king of Judah. Well, how did that happen? Well, it's a little something called share and share alike. How many have ever heard that phrase, share and share alike? My parents used to tell us that phrase all the time when we were kids, because they wanted something, you know, when we had something, they wanted us to share with my siblings. And the idea was that when my siblings had something, they would share with us, right? So share and share alike. It didn't always work out that way, mind you, but that was the lesson, right? You need to share with other people, and when they have something, they will share with you. Oh, remember when we talked about how the Amalekites came and they took David's family and all his people's family and possessions away, and that David sent some of the army to go and get it back? Well, here's what happened there. 200 of David's men went to get their family and possessions to bring them back. But 200 stayed at the camp, the Bible says, because they were exhausted. And so when these 200 men go and get the family and possessions and everything back, as they're coming back to camp, they say to David, we should keep all the stuff to ourselves because we're the ones that went and did all the work. And these guys, they stayed back at camp because they were too exhausted. So we're going to keep it all ourselves and we're not going to give any of it to them. But David says this, no, my brothers, don't be selfish with what the Lord has given us. He's kept us safe and helped us defeat the band of raiders that attacked us. Who will listen to you when you talk like this? Say it with me. We share and share alike. Those who go to battle and those who guard the equipment. From then on, David made this a decree and a regulation for Israel, and it is still followed to this day. So now you know where it comes from. Share and share alike. David says, you need to share what you have with other people around you. So I heard this story about this elderly couple that went to a fast food restaurant, and they bought a hamburger meal, okay? And so they sit down, and the man opens the burger, and he cuts the burger perfectly in half, and he puts half in front of his wife and half in front of himself, and then he counts out the fries evenly, and he puts half in front of her and half in front of himself, and he takes a sip of the drink, and he gives it to his wife. She takes a sip, and she puts it down between them. And then the man just starts eating his half of the burger. Well, there's this young man nearby, and he sees this going on. He feels terrible. He's like, they can't even afford two meals. They have to split one between them. So he feels so bad, so he goes over to them, and he politely asks, would it be okay if I buy you another meal so you don't have to split it? And the old man looks at him and says, oh, thank you very much, but no, we're fine. We just like to share everything. So the young man goes away, and the old guy, you know, eats his burger, and he's just about to start his fries, but his wife hasn't touched her food at all. She's just sitting there. And so the young guy comes back, and he says, you know, I just can't help but see what's going on. I just would really like to buy you another meal. It's not a big deal. He says to her, I just noticed you haven't eaten anything. Would you let me buy you a meal? She says, no, that's fine. Thank you. We just like to share everything. So the young man goes away and he sits there and he just can't get away from it. And the old guy eats his fries. The woman's just sitting there not touching her food and takes a drink every once in a while, but she's not eating her food. And the old guy finishes his fries. The young guy comes over and he goes, okay, I just see you not eating a thing. He says, what are you waiting for? She says, I'm waiting for him to share the teeth. Don't try that at home, ladies and gentlemen. That's like sharing everything. Share and share alike. Just keep your teeth to yourself, okay? So David says, we got to share and share alike. And here's what David does that was so tactically smart and brilliant. This is why he becomes king of Judah. So remember when Saul was chasing him and they were running from all these towns and villages, caves and wilderness, all that kind of stuff. Remember, they needed some people to provide. They had 400 men, right, and families. They needed people to provide food and sustenance for them. Well, all along these towns of Judah, that's what people did. They gave them some of their stuff. They shared with what they had with David and his men. Well, now David does, he takes some of the plunder from the Amalekites, and he chooses to share it back with all those people who bless them. And he gives all this stuff back to all these towns and villages and all these people who shared with them along the journey. So now that the door opens, Saul dies, all these people in Judah, they go, man, we want David as our king. Because David shares and shares alike. And so that's how David became king of Judah. Now, there's a problem. Because Saul's son Ishbosheth, some people were loyal to Saul, and some people were loyal to David. And so the Bible says this was the beginning of a long war between those who were loyal to Saul and those loyal to David. As time passed, David became stronger and stronger, while Saul's dynasty became weaker and weaker. So, I said there was two obstacles, right? There was Saul's son Ishbosheth, and so the civil war broke out. But there's also the Philistines. Now, the Philistines wanted to keep Israel and Judah weak, but they made a tactical error because when they saw Israel and Judah fighting, they thought, man, we're just going to sit back and let them duke it out because they're going to make each other weak. Well, what actually happened was Ishbosheth and his people got weaker and weaker, but David and his men got stronger and stronger. So David got to the point where he was so strong, he could handle whatever the Philistines were giving him. So David actually developed an elite troop force of 30,000 men. So strong and so big at this point in time. And so just by way of interest, David was about 30 when he became king of Judah, and about 7 years later, he became king of all Israel, all of Israel and Judah together. And this is a moment where David does something so significant that I want to zero in on for a moment. He does something so significant, so important, that would mark his reign as a king, and that was really important for the nation of Israel in this moment. David decides that he's going to go and get the Ark of the Covenant and bring it back to the center of Israel into Jerusalem. Now, the Ark of the Covenant was also called the Ark of the Testimony. Now, the Ark is not like Noah's Ark, okay? It's not a boat. It's a different word in Hebrew that they translate as Ark of the Testimony. And what this is a big box. And this box has some things in it that are very important. Most important are the Ten Commandments, the tablets, that God gave to Moses on Mount Sinai. And these tablets are in this box, this ark. And what's supposed to happen is they're to keep this box with them everywhere they go, right from Mount Sinai, right through to Canaan, the Promised Land. It should be in the center of everything that they do as a nation, because the Ten Commandments, this was a testimony of God. It's the testimony of God's presence with the people, and a testimony of the Word of God to the people, and how the people are to live the Word of God so other people know it. So it's really, really important. It's really important for them to share with one another the testimony of who God is, so they remind one another. And it's also important for them to share with other people and other nations about who God really is. The Ark was really important. But Israel started to mistreat and misunderstand the point of the Ark. They started to use it kind of like it was had magical powers. Like they could just use it in order to get their own way. There was one time, a number of years before, Philistines and Israel were in battle. The Philistines were winning. And so the Israelites decided, let's go get the ark and let's bring it to the center so that everything can change, so that we'll win the battle ultimately. But God wouldn't allow his word and his testimony to be manipulated like that. And so he allowed the Philistines to actually capture the ark. How many times do we do something similar? We kind of ignore the Word of God, we ignore our testimony, but then when things aren't going so well for us, that's when we bring it to the forefront of our lives, that's when we bring it to the front. We're like, man, God, fix my life, fix my problems. I want to tell you something, God cannot be used. God's not like a can of Febreze that you can just keep in the cupboard hidden away somewhere, and then when life stinks, you just pull it out and you spray a little prayer around so that all of a sudden your life is like a fresh spring breeze again. God cannot be used. He won't be manipulated like that. His word and his testimony to you is not some magical power. You can just slam on the end of whatever you say and expect him to do what you want him to do. He's God. And so he allowed the ark to be captured by the Philistines. Now, they didn't have it for very long, because everywhere that this ark was, there was calamity that broke out amongst the town. And so they were like, man, we don't want it in our town. And they kept shoving it to all these different towns. And people were like, well, I don't want it either. It was like a game of hot potato with the ark, right? And so finally they were like, no, get it back to Israel. Get it out of here. And so they brought it to this place called Kiriath Jearim. How many know where Kiriath Jearim is? Exactly. Not many. Because it's this nothing border town that nobody really knows about. But here's why I bring it up. Because Israel let the ark stay there for 20 years. 20 years they let it stay in Kiriath Jearim. Not in the center of Israel, not in the center of all the activity, not hidden away where they didn't pay much attention to it. Even though the ark was the symbol of the presence of God, even though the ark was right in the middle of everything they did, it was a symbol of the word of God to them. Even though while they traveled with the ark from Sinai to Canaan, God protected them. God provided for them manna in the wilderness. God blessed them in so many ways. God led them to the promised land. God fulfilled his prophecy and his testimony to them. Even though God had given them his story that they should share with one another and share to other nations, even though all this was true, they kept it hidden. Kiriath Jearim. You could probably guess where the application is. How many times do we do the same thing? When God has given us his story, his testimony of his truth and his goodness, we become so aware of the amazing things that God has done in our lives and how he's transformed us, and yet and we keep it hidden. There's some people in this room, it's been probably 20 years since you told someone else who doesn't know about God your story. There are some here that's been a long time, and you feel like, well, maybe the reason is because you don't have a big story to tell. I got to tell you something. If God's in your story's big because God is big. Can I hear an amen to that? And so many times I find in my life that if something is truly important to me, I will find a way to do it. And if it is not, I will find a way to excuse it. And so often we make these excuses, eh? Well, I don't see anybody else doing it, so I'm not going to do it. I mean, I'm sure there were some Israelites who thought, man, I don't see anybody else bringing it out of Kiriath Jearim. Why should I be the one to do it? And we're so conscious of what other people might say or what other people might think about us, we get all Wilt Chamberlain with our story. Like, I don't know what anybody else is going to say. I don't want to feel weird and awkward, and so I'm not going to do it. I'm just going to do what everybody else does. Instead, we should be like Rick Barry and tell the story and get it out there. Well, David was more like Rick Barry. David decided that what was most important is that we got to get the word of God, we got to get the truth of God, the story of God, back into the center of our lives, back into the center of our families, back into the center of attention. We got to get it back to Jerusalem. So David does what he normally does. He writes a song, and you can read the song, Psalm 132. You can read it this afternoon sometime. David writes this song, and he mobilizes those 30,000 troops, and they go down to Kiriath Jearim to get the Ark of the Testimony and bring it back to Jerusalem, to the center of everything. And while they're doing that, David is singing this song he wrote. He is celebrating. He is dancing. He's shouting. He's like, he's not being a normal king, right? He's not just shooting the shot like a normal king, you know, just walking very formal like a king would walk to make sure this formal, I don't know if that's how kings walk. I don't think that's actually it. But he's like dancing, he's shouting, this is actually what the Bible says. And David danced before the Lord with all his might, wearing a priestly garment. So David and all the people of Israel brought up the ark of the Lord with shouts of joy and the blowing of ram horns. I want to tell you something. When you start boldly telling your testimony in front of other people will join you and come along. It just will, because it's God's truth and it's his story. And he's just letting it rip. Man, he's flying. He just can't be loud enough, shout enough. And if you think our worship's loud, man, that would have been 10 times louder. They're just ripping those horns. I don't know if you've ever heard a ram's horn, but it's loud. And they're just having fun, and this is exciting. This is a celebration. But David's wife in the palace sees him acting like this, and she's embarrassed. She's like, I can't believe you're doing that. I mean, how embarrassing. That's not being very kingly. And I love the Bible. It tells the story so, you know, well. And David, when he finally, after he's done and they've got the ark in its place and everything, and he comes home, he walks in home, and he sees his wife, and his wife goes, oh, no, you didn't do what I just saw you do. Why are you acting all like a scrub? And she gets all on him, and she's all salty with him. Well, it wasn't exactly how she said it. Here's what happened. When David returned home to bless his own family, Michal, the daughter of Saul, came out to meet him. She said in disgust, how distinguished the king of Israel looked today, shamelessly exposing himself to the servant girls like any vulgar person might do. Hey, listen to me. That's not what happened. That's not what happened. Whenever you start telling your story, whenever you start doing what God's calling you to do, other people will be critical of you, and they'll blow it way out of proportion. They'll say things that aren't true. They'll make it seem like it's not really okay. That's not what happened. David was righteous. He was the right thing. He was letting it rev a little high. Yeah, I'm sure he was, but he had good reason to. And she's getting all Wilt Chamberlain on him. And he's being all Rick Barry. And I got to tell you something, ladies and gentlemen. There's two kinds of people when it comes to your story. You can either be a tucker or you can be a talker. A tucker is the kind of person who just hides your story so no one else can see and you don't embarrass yourself in front of anybody. Or you can be a talker and you just let her fly because other people need to see it. Everybody say tucker or talker. Tucker or talker. Yeah. And here's what I've learned about being a tucker or being a talker. A tucker cares about what other people see. A talker cares about what God sees. oh yeah, I'm going to start preaching now. A talker cares if people will call them a fool. A talker thinks it's foolish to care about being called a fool by a fool. A talker says, I don't need to be so bold with my testimony. A talker says, I will do, go, say, be, whatever it takes to tell people about Jesus. Come on, say amen to that. A talker looks down on what other people say. A talker asks the Lord to help them know what to say. A talker keeps everyone else's scorecard. A talker recognizes that the only vote that matters is the one you're talking for, singing for, dancing for, clapping for, shouting for. And a talker thinks that your testimony is too personal to be public, but a talker knows that your testimony is too powerful to be kept private. There's two kinds of people when it comes to your story, a talker or a talker. Which one are you going to be? How can we not be a talker after Jesus has done all of this for us? How can we not celebrate? How can we not shout it? How can we not let the world know? Because I'll tell you, the Bible says one day, every knee will bow, every tongue will confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. You might as well get a head start right now. We got to get talking about Jesus and not be so concerned about what other people think when we do. David says to his wife, oh, you didn't like what you just saw? Well, guess what, honey? You ain't going to like what you're going to see next. He says, I was dancing before the Lord, who chose me above your father and all his family. He appointed me as the leader of Israel, the people of the Lord. So I celebrate before the Lord. Yes, I'm willing to look even more foolish than this, to be humiliated in my own eyes. He's like, it's the Lord I'm concerned about. It's the Lord that I'm focusing on. And I'm not as concerned about what other people might say or think about how I'm talking about my Lord, how I'm talking about his grace, how I'm talking about his goodness, how I'm talking about what he's done in my life. And here's what David knows. Here's what David knows. It's best for the team. It's best for the team for you to talk and tell your story. It's best for the team. It's best for everyone in the stands to see you do the right thing and make the right point about who God is. But here's the best thing about it all. Jesus is the true and better David. See, David understood it's better to be humiliated in front of other people to make sure that you're living a life of worship before God. But Jesus knew it better than David did. See, because the Bible says that Jesus did not consider equality with God something to hold on to, but he made himself low, humble, humiliated like a servant, and became like us. Jesus was God, and he was willing to be humiliated for our sake so that you and I could hear the story, the big story about God and his love and his grace and his mercy on our lives. And that portion that I just talked about is Philippians 2. It's the context for the story for our memory verse. And it's that same God that gives you the desire and the power to be able to do what's right, what God's calling you to do. To be able to tell your story with other people. And here's the big thing. Here's the great thing. What David couldn't even understand about his story. He's in the middle of this. He's just doing what he knows he should do. But there's a bigger story going on, a bigger picture. See, the top of that box, he just knew that that Ark of the Testimony needed to be the center of his life and center of his family. But the top of that box is called the mercy seat. And once a year, the priest would go into the Holy of Holies and he would sacrifice an animal on the top of that box. And the blood was a symbol of the forgiveness of the sins of all the people. And what David couldn't even understand in that moment, that was a foreshadowing of the great sacrifice of Jesus Christ, who would give his life and shed his blood so you and I would have the forgiveness of sins. So that you and I could put our faith in Jesus. And so his story becomes part of our story. That is the bigger picture. What we're going to do to finish today is something a little different. I'm going to ask the ushers to help us, and they're going to hand a piece of paper out to you. And we all know that we have a challenge with telling our story, and so we're just giving this little piece of paper to just help you kind of walk through your testimony. And we're going to finish by sharing our story with someone around us, okay? Now, if you are just new, and you're just go ahead, ushers, and start handing them out. And if you're new and you aren't sure about this whole Jesus thing, and if Jesus is who he said he is, that's okay. You can just tell where you're at. Just tell what your questions are, your doubts are. You're not, I mean, you're here on a long weekend. That's something, right? So just, you could just tell one another. You're going to keep these sheets of paper, and you can write them out in full later. We're not going to take the time to do that now. But you can use this as a little guide to tell your story to someone else around. Now, before we do that, before we have you do that, I want to pray. And before I pray, let me just say a couple of things. Mums and dads, if I can get your attention, mums and dads, some of your families, your kids don't know your story. Like, you know your story, and maybe some other people know your story, but your kids don't even know your story. I want to encourage you to take the time today to tell your kids your story, your questions, your doubts, where you were at before you came to faith in Jesus, and let your kids know your story. I think it's so important for them to know that and do that. And so what I want you to do after I pray is we're going to have you share your story. Now, maybe you're here with your spouse, and the easy thing for you would be to tell your spouse your story, because your spouse probably knows your story. Maybe not. So maybe that's a good place for you to talk. Maybe you want to take it a step further, and you want to talk to somebody that you don't know and tell them your story, okay? Because if you're not willing to do that in here, it's probably not likely you're going to do that out there. So maybe that's what you want to do. And we're not going to take a long time to do this. Just tell your story in 2 minutes, okay? Just a 2-minute story of your testimony. And do that with one another. The team's going to play a song. And I don't want anybody to leave at this time. We're finishing early here. So I don't want you to leave, because after the song, I've got something important I want to tell you and show you. So we're just going to do this together. So that's how it's going to go. I'm going to pray, and then we're going to have you share. We're going to sing a song, and then I'm going to dismiss you, okay? Let's bow our heads in prayer for a moment. And just as we do, I always want to give an opportunity for someone to put your faith in Jesus, because that's the whole point of the story, right? The whole point of the story is not just to be entertained on a Sunday morning, but actually to make the story your story. So maybe you've never done that before, and you've never said, you know, I actually believe Jesus is who he said he is. He's a son of God. And I realize that I've sinned, and no matter how good I become, I can't become good enough to become perfect. That's the standard for righteousness. I can't become perfect because I've messed up. I need someone perfect to make up that gap for me, and that's Jesus. The Bible says as soon as we put our faith in Jesus, he cleanses us from our sins, gives us the hope of eternal life. If you're not sure, if you were to die today, that you would be in the presence of Jesus for eternity, I want to encourage you to make that decision of faith today. So maybe you've never done that before, you want to do that, or maybe you've done that before and you just realize you've gotten off track and you want to redecide to follow Jesus with faith. If that's you, with heads bowed and eyes closed, I'm not going to embarrass anybody or bring them up, but if you just respond by raising your hand, I'd like to acknowledge you and pray with you. Is there anyone here? Yes, thank you, sir. Yes, ma'am, thank you, thank you. Anyone else? You say, yeah. Yeah, thanks, man, at the back. Appreciate it. Yeah. Anyone else? You say, yeah, that's me, pastor. I just want to put my faith in Jesus in a fresh way. Anyone else? Just wait for a moment. Join these 4 or 5 people who raise their hands. Lord Jesus, we bow before you. We thank you that even though we recognize we've sinned and fallen short of your perfection, we know that you're perfect and you forgive us and you love us. And I thank you for these folks who raise their hand. Lord, that you just cleanse them right there in that moment. They don't have to do anything else. You've forgiven them, cleansed them. They've got eternity to look forward to with you. Thank you, Jesus, for that. And for all of us, Lord, we recognize we can do that at any moment. just put our faith in you, and you cleanse us and you change us. For those of us who made that decision again, just to continue to redecide to follow you, help us, God. And for all of us who have a hard time sharing our story, God, give us boldness, we pray. Help us to see our life in the context of the big picture, your story, the great things you've done in our lives. Help us not to let the crowd dictate our behavior. Let us follow you regardless of the cost. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. So just before you go, I want to just invite my friend Doug to come up. And Doug is a guy I met at an indoor driving range 4 years ago. And golf driving range. And I'd never met him before, didn't know him. And we just got talking one day, and Doug was going through some challenging stuff. I shared my story with Doug, and Doug shared his story with me. And Doug had not gone to church for a real long time, and lots of circumstances going on in his life that were tough. And that was 4 years ago. I invited him to come to church on an Easter weekend, and he came to church for the first time and has been coming ever since, and gave his heart to Jesus and is walking along with the Lord and has a great story. And so 2 years ago, some of you may have seen, we did a testimony, Doug's story. You know how we show these testimony, video testimonies? Well, Doug was one of the ones that we did 2 years ago. But since that time, the reason I bring him up, but since that time, Doug shows that story to everybody. And it's been a great way for him to be able to start a conversation with other people about the Lord. So, Doug, can you just share?
Sure, absolutely. Thanks, Kev. So, it's really interesting because I was actually just talking to a friend of mine today on the way down to church, and I was saying how I was coming to talk about how I share my story. And YouTube being the number one website in the world, I mean, this testimonial, is just a great way for me to allow people to see how God has touched my life and how much it has seeped into every single pore of me, both from my family to my kids to my job, and how much it actually has changed me in the last 4 years and made such a cornerstone of my life that I just rely on it so much. And one of the really cool things is, I was saying to my friend, you know, it's great. He's like, wow, you're going to stand up in front of your whole congregation and tell them this? I said, yeah. He goes, so many people are so scared, like Will Chamberlain changed, you know, their free throw. So many people are so scared about other people's opinions about what their beliefs are. I truly believe that because of this video and the ability to share my view, I'm a golf professional. And so one of the things is it's a great way to start the discussion about how Jesus and God can change your life and let you become and feel so much more than you have in the past, and that you have people and this wonderful church behind you helping you discover God's love every single day of your life.
Amen. Amen. So, that's great. Would you give God praise for that? Isn't that cool?
Thank you.
So here's what we want you to do. We want you to take those testimony sheets, and we'd love to be able to make a testimony video for you. We'd love for you to have a testimony that you could use, you know, because it's a great door. When you just, you know, somebody's going through something, say, hey, let me just text you my story, watch it, and tell me what you think. It's just a great way to kick the door open and tell the story. So it'd take us a while to do everybody's testimony, but write your story down and maybe take a copy of it for yourself and then send it in to us, and we'd love to be in touch with you and help you tell your story.
I did that actually just this morning, Kev. A young man that I know from college who I taught posted something on social media that was touched me pretty much because he's going through a really tough time, and I was like, you need to, you know, just take a look. And it was really funny. So I sent that to him at first service, and on my way out coming back, he sent me a text. He said, I can't wait to watch this. I'm going to call you this week.
Oh, that's awesome. See, that's great. And I just got a little thing here, which is so awesome. This is a little picture. Thanks, buddy, for bringing this up. This is a picture of kind of people together, eh? Family together, telling the story. We're in it together, eh, pal? Yeah, come here. Give me five. Bless you, man. That's awesome. Can I pray for you, Riley? Can we pray together? Let's pray, everybody. Lord Jesus, we thank you. You've told us to come like little children. And so I pray that we will do that, just like Riley. And we'll come and lay our story at your cross, lay our story down in front of others, and that so many more people would join your family. Bless Riley and his family, and this whole family. In Jesus' name.